Mark Tatum, Deputy Commissioner and COO of the National Basketball Association.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here with you all.
Dr. Richard Lapchick, thanks for being with us here on R&R on Sports.
Thank you for having me.
Civil rights icon, Dr. Edwards, how are you today?
I'm doing a heck of a lot better than I deserve, I'll tell you that.
Sports commentator, Scoop Jackson.
Good to be back on with you all.
Ken Griffey Jr., how are you today, sir?
I'm good. How about you guys?
It's R&R on Sports.
R&R on Sports. R&R.
Hello world. R&R on Sports is in the house yet again. I'm Howard Robertson.
And I am the stunning, the marvelous, the fascinating,
stunning.
The awesome, the wonderful Larry Robinson.
You know,
oh,
you
man, you know America, man.
It's America.
You always mess up, man.
What you talking about?
You always get stuff confused. Are you dyslexic?
What you talking about?
You said stunning.
Yeah.
You meant stunned. It's not ING. It's
ED.
ED.
Stunned.
ED.
I'm stunned because I'm looking at you and this ugly hat you got on.
ED in another way, too. What's up, baby boy?
Oh, man, it's all good,
Happy
brother.
Saturday morning.
Happy Saturday to you, my man.
Thank you. I'm on this low-carb thing, so
low-carb?
I cannot join you in the Baileys. Well, we got to quit saying Baileys. In the Irish cream and coffee.
Well, you know, man.
I
drink enough
coffee and coffee.
Okay, well, I drink enough.
With Splenda.
Well, that low-carb diet.
Yeah, man.
That keto. Is it keto?
But I'm not. It was nothing formal. I had lunch with a friend of mine, and he just said he was doing, he looked really, really good.
Uh-huh.
And he said it was good. So I decided to do it, to try it out in February, just mm-hmm. to.
For Black History Month.
So there would be less of me during right. Black History Month.
Right.
And it's really been phenomenal. I have diabetes.
Right.
And my blood sugar hadn't been this low in years.
Well, let me tell you what's working for me.
I've lost 10 pounds.
I see you, brother. You're looking slim. You was about 350.
Wait, boy,
You're like 325.
To
335.
Like
I'm sorry. 335. Well, listen, man. Now I tell you what I've been doing is I've been doing this intermittent dieting thing, you know, intermittent fasting. And it's been working exceptionally well. Once again, another diabetic over
What's
here.
What's the fast like? What kind of fast?
I don't eat before 12 noon. You know, I get up in the morning.
You don't
lot
eat
of,
before
lot of,
12?
Yeah, a lot of liquids.
Or you don't, I've done, no,
lot
heard
of liquids.
You don't eat after a certain time.
Nah, I just don't eat before 12 noon. You know,
what does that do?
It has actually been great for me. I mean, once again, I drink a lot of liquids, a lot of water. I don't do any sugar or carbonated drinks or anything like
that,
tea.
I look at that.
But literally, man, it's been great. Blood sugar level, A1C is exceptionally low.
Yeah.
Right at around 5.5. So, I mean, you know, so we're doing well. So I know you guys are here to talk sports.
5'5".
But, you know.
Same as your height.
Anyway, says the man who's actually shrinking.
But
so what's up, man?
Say full disclosure. So last week, anybody who listened to us last week heard us cut up about the new rules for the NBA All-Star Game.
Right.
Okay. Now, we meant that. We still believe that it was drug-induced. The rules themselves were done under the influence. But they worked.
They worked, man.
The game was better.
Oh, much better.
No doubt.
You know what
we're going to talk about that when we come back.
Okay,
no doubt the game was better.
Oh, no doubt about that, man. I'm good. I just think that it was just the energy that was injected into the game was just phenomenal. And then I think the tributes and whatnot also had an impact because they realized that this was a special game because it was the first Kobe MVP mm-hmm. award, mm-hmm. things like that. Mm-hmm. So we'll get more into the details on the other side.
Yeah, right? Ernie was the only one on the announcer team that understood what the score was supposed to be or whatever.
But trying to figure it out.
Yeah,
like,
right. Yeah, yeah. And they didn't try to figure that stuff out. But we'll be back for more R&R on Sports right after this. Don't you go anywhere.
Stay right there.
Hey, this is Dr. J.
This is Shaq Adoshis.
Yo, what's up? This is Ice Cube.
And you're listening to a little R&R.
R&R on Sports.
Hello, my love. I heard a kiss from you. Red magic set to
welcome back. R&R on Sports. And I'm sitting here looking at my brief.
Uh-huh. What you got? What's going on?
Jeremy, you want to explain this part? It says NBA All-Star Game, a success, question mark. And then it says Eat Crow.
Oh, so he was expecting that we were going to come in and be like, yeah.
Look at him.
Yeah, he's telling us to eat crow as a producer. What's up with that? What's up with that, producer?
Oh, my goodness.
So you're going to just tell us that we got to
eat crow?
We have
nothing to eat crow about.
Listen, man, them boys were still
You know they PA. Were tripping when they made those rules. Man, it just so happened that it was indeed instrumental in making an otherwise.
How does the saying go? Even a blind squirrel finds a nut here and there.
That's right.
That's right.
Even a broke clock is right two times a day.
Yeah. So listen, son. Don't be trying to tell us to eat
crow.
See, listen, check him out.
We don't have to have an off mic conversation.
I'm telling you.
With Brother Jeremy. So, yeah, I mean, it worked out. It moved it along. But it was still, the game was still notoriously NBA. Boy, they were jacking up 42 footers.
Yeah, I'm not really feeling this whole era of shooting from the logo. And I'm just not, man. It's horrible basketball. But let me say this. There's a few things that I want to call attention to that I really think made a huge difference. Number one was the fact that they played real defense. I mean, that was for a change.
It got serious.
Yeah, it got serious. Yeah, about halfway through the third quarter.
And they started playing.
Things started getting real serious, and it was entertaining. It looked like the guys were having fun. I think the players enjoyed it even more.
Mm-hmm.
I still think the math on the whole 24 plus the T with the combined score, all that's crazy.
That's crazy.
But it totally made it competitive. It brought passion to it. It was intense.
The money for the nonprofits, the money for the charities, that works too.
Yes.
I mean, because you got the kids and it means something in terms of that as well.
Right.
I like
that. And a lot of those boys, you know, a lot of the players probably saw themselves as those kids.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that gave them an extra incentive to make sure they won.
And I think it was absolutely befitting that Kawhi Leonard became the first Kobe Bryant most valuable MVP.
Why you say that?
Well, I think I like his style in terms of that. I think he showed up. I think he played very, very well.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like the fact that he's very quiet, very unassuming. I like that. Something about that that's unique, unusual, and appealing.
Absolutely. And with that, we're going to take another break, and we're going to be right back. Because we got to get into this baseball thing. See, your lying self done rubbed off on the Houston Astros. See?
Oh, it was me.
Yeah, it was you. It was you.
Back
man.
After this.
Riffin' on Jazz.
When two friends get together to kick it
about jazz, it's called Riffin' on Jazz.
Catch us Riffin' on Jazz every week right here on your favorite broadcast or podcast platforms.
Riffin' on Jazz on the KUDZUKIAN Network.
KUDZUKIAN!
Hello, everybody. This is Tim Brown, 2015 NFL Hall of Fame inductee, and you are listening to R&R on Sports.
Sweat running all over my chest. I don't quit, no. I just press harder than I ever did before.
Thanks for being back for more R&R on Sports. So, and the other thing that they should never, never, ever, ever, ever do again in NBA All-Star history is to ask Chaka Khan to sing the national anthem.
Man, she was just hollering for no reason.
She it was just, it was like it was, spiteful.
It was like.
It was a spiteful rendition. And that's a great word because she sounded like she was trying to punish somebody.
She did. She punished me.
She was yelling.
Because I felt uncomfortable for her.
She was yelling.
That was terrible.
And she.
It was like over the top terrible.
Too terrible. She was like trying to be too soulful. You know what I'm saying? And it was all forced.
It was nothing natural about her rendition of the national anthem.
That was terrible.
Well, on to these lying mugs.
How'd you like the Kobe tribute?
All right. No, everything was wonderful, man. I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed all aspects of the game. Big appreciation for the Rising Star game, seeing John Morant and my guy Zion Williamson.
And Brandon Clark on the other team.
Yeah, I mean they really did look good. Jaren Jackson looked good. I mean, but all the games, all the events from the skills challenge, the dunk contest was maybe one of the best dunk contests in history.
Did the right person win?
Let me say this. The right person did win, and the right person didn't win.
Oh, what is that?
And the wrong person lost.
That's what's so because I, you're just I, a pancake I believe, today.
No, no.
You're
I
just
believe,
a pancake today.
No, I believe.
Flip him over. Whichever end he ends up on is all right.
No.
I think, because I still think. And the wrong person won.
Listen, man. Listen, I don't know who talked like that, but listen, but listen here. You had a guy with 550 dunks that lost the dunk contest. And I just don't believe that Aaron Gordon, with the creativity, he's been one of the most creative dunkers for the last two times he's been in it than anybody I've ever seen. That one where he caught the ball off the backboard and off the side of the backboard and did the 360.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I was like, goodness gracious alive.
Read a newspaper, crossed his legs.
Yeah, I'm telling you, that brother, man. I mean, he was doing stuff that I didn't even think were humanly possible. So I asked people,
how tall is Taco Fall? And I've heard everything from 7'6" to 8'9".
No. He could have been 10 foot. But that brother jumped over a dude over 7'3". Let's just say he's over 7'3". And he jumped over him. So how do you not win a dunk contest?
Yeah.
When you jump over, everything else being equal, you jump over a 7 foot.
Go to the barbershop this weekend. I challenge you to go to the barber, any barbershop, go any black barbershop, go to the barbershop and just say, how tall is Taco Fall? That boy 8'7". Oh, no, I saw it. Google. I know his mama. He 8'7".
I know his mama.
Yeah, he was 6'3" when he was born. Out the womb. You're listening to R&R on Sports on the Kudzukian Network, and we're happy about it. So, all right.
Now, we got to get to this.
Let's move to a little b-ball.
Baseball.
Baseball's been good to me.
Now, it ain't been good to me. Because I'm telling you, I'm like LeBron, man. Baseball's been really good to the Astros. I would be mad in a mug. Because, man, you think about the ripple effect of them cheating.
So, wait. For those who might have been in an underground bunker somewhere, tell them what you're talking about.
All right,
bring them up to date.
So quickly, the Houston Astros were found to be sign stealing and using video to sign steal during their championship runs. Namely, 2017, it was actually proven that they were cheating. And the MLB came out and stated that they were cheating. And also, Manfred, the commissioner, even decided to render a punishment. Woefully underpunish these guys for literally being a total black eye to baseball historically.
Mm-hmm.
This will go down as one of the worst events in the history of Major League Baseball. And he basically gave these guys a slap on the wrist. And what I'm saying to baseball, if they don't fix this, you're going to have a real hard
slap
time.
On the wrist and said you can keep
you can keep playing. Keep your championship. Keep playing. You get your money. Keep your money. Keep everything the way it is. But we're going to suspend the manager and the team president.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's just ridiculous. What's your take on it, brother? What's your take?
I think it shows baseball in its truest light. And it is probably one of the second possibly to the NCAA, but it is the most, at this juncture, the most hypocritical sports organization of all time.
Oh, wow.
Because look at all of the scrutiny, look at all of the squeaky, clean scrubbing that is required to be a Hall of Famer.
Oh, wow.
A baseball Hall of Famer.
You want to talk about cheating?
You want to talk about cheating? Look at that. Look at all of the people who have been accused through the years of cheating.
Oh, my God. I mean, you kept the Rocket out of Hall of Fame.
Never, ever be in the Baseball Hall of Fame.
You've kept Barry Bonds out of the Hall of Fame. You can go down the list. But what gets me even more is that the brand of Clayton Kershaw, because of that series, is that he's a choker.
Mm-hmm.
He was having to pitch against folks that knew what was coming. I mean, that affected his ERA. I mean, it affected every single thing about how these guys are paid and how they are respected within the game. They will go down forever as non-winners.
Do you know how much of an advantage it is when the element of surprise about what the next pitch is going to be is not there? Do you know how much of an advantage that is?
Absolutely.
This guy has set you up with certain pitches and is about to close you out.
Right.
Pitching is like a chess game. It's a series. You plan it in series. It's not one at a time.
Right.
And this guy has set you up, and he's about to throw you a curveball, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You're not supposed to know. You're waiting on it. You're sitting on ready.
Waiting. Just to knock that mug out the park.
What?
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty sad, man. I think Houston, man, they've got to do something. Major League Baseball, Commissioner Manfred, you've got to do something beyond what you've done. This is terrible.
You will forever
be looked at as just a unhonorable organization.
He ain't got to do nothing but be white and die.
Oh,
that's all he got to do.
Wow. Well, that's disappointing.
You can take that and go on somewhere else. It's done. It is. Listen, we got a fabulous show for you today. We got an excellent show for you today. We've got, you got to stick around and see what we got. We got an NBA world champion, and we've got an NCAA champion. All in the same person out here on R&R on Sports. Check us out. Come
Rose
back.
Rose from Abject Poverty.
Great story. More R&R after this. Things I do for you. I do for no one else. Welcome back to R&R on Sports.
Back.
We, as always, have fantastic guests that you don't just tune in anywhere else to hear. Today is no different. We are happy to have, and there are a lot of descriptors here.
Well, let me hear some of them.
But I'm going to start out with.
You can start with champion. So
champion. I was going to say athlete, but champion, that's a better word.
Champion.
So we're going to start out with champion, author, philanthropist, screenwriter, producer, entrepreneur. How about that one?
Oh, yeah.
Talking about Derek Anderson. Welcome to R&R on Sports, my brother.
I appreciate you having me on, man. Can't wait to get this one going.
But see, listen, man, you're going to have to put some more respect on his name, because not only is he all those things,
okay,
he is my homeboy, Louisvillian, from the West End.
We're not going to hold that against
him. Yeah, we're going to prop him up because of that, because right, we need to be edified.
And don't you
that.
Be trying to lean on his shield, because you'll mess it up. You mess it up. Derek, glad to have you, man. And now, I mean, I cannot begin to tell your story. I've read it, and it is most amazing. But NCAA champion is part of it.
You got
that ring, and NBA champion is another part of it. So
No. You know what? I got something better than that, man.
What?
Kill your question. Here you go. Listen, man. I want to know, how can you be born and raised in Louisville, Kentucky, and know that University of Louisville was our pro team? How in the world did you end up at Ohio State, man? Did they not recruit you at Louisville?
No, I got recruited, but I think what happens is, some coaches, I think their arrogance sometimes becomes a part of their mistakes.
Okay.
And sometimes when you look at some of the coaches, I think their arrogance comes from just being successful.
Okay.
And I like Denny Crum. I think he's a good person. But I think what they did was, because I was a hometown guy, they just assumed that I would sign without asking questions.
Okay.
And they didn't understand my childhood and the way I grew up, because I didn't have parents. Of course, you'll
so talk. No. We want you to talk about that. Talk about that. Tell our listeners about your growing up.
Well, in brief scenario, it's basically my dad was in the Vietnam War. He came back, and they were trying to find a way to survive, and mm-hmm. he came back. He became a street guy, and my mother and him, they went to the street life, and it was rough for my brother and I. And we grew up in Southwick, where it was like it's probably like five minutes, not even that long from where Cassius Clay then, Muhammad Ali, grew up from.
Mm-hmm.
So we were used to guys just trying to find our own way, and it was a street life. And once they did that, my brother and I became a victim of their stuff. And my dad beat my mother up. My mother tried to shoot him, tried to kill him. Fortunately, he didn't die. He left me at 10 years old. I literally watched him walk away. And my dad was 6'9", so I was like,
wow.
He was a real giant. Yeah, he was a giant. And I didn't see him for 20-something years. My mother, I came home to an empty apartment. My mother just left. My brother ran away from home. My mother came. I came home at 11 years old, and my mother just left. Wasn't no note, wasn't no food, wasn't no nothing. She just left. I had my stuff in my old room, and door was open. I was like, man, this is...
So your brother had run away, so you're alone now?
Yeah, I was alone. So I grew up in a project. So I was in a place called Payton Place, and it was mm-hmm. right across from there.
Mm-hmm.
And I basically just went to other people's houses, just asked to stay the night, wore other people's clothes. I did that for a few years, and stayed with a high school girlfriend. Her dad was a janitor at the high school. I used to sleep behind our stage.
Wow.
Because we had practice on Saturday, so I used to sleep on the stage on Friday nights. I'd get some food out of the little vending machine.
And,
I was saving up because I knew the situation was coming. I practiced Saturday as a freshman.
Right.
And then he found out my situation. He let me spend the night at his house. So I started dating his daughter. She was 3 years older than me, and she got pregnant, and I was 14. She was 17.
Wow.
I stayed with them through that school year, my freshman year. And then she got pregnant. Her and her mother were arrested for shoplifting. So dude was like, man, I don't know what you're going to do, but you and the baby can't stay. So I had to go back to my old neighborhood, the lady next door. Where I used to live, she's had a little, it wasn't a real daycare.
Right.
It wasn't legal. She kept kids, so she kept my son while I went to school, played basketball. I worked at a candy store, White Size, on Algonquin Parkway from 5:30 to 8. And then on weekends, I worked at Paper Route for 2 years. And then my junior, my senior year, I stayed with my Uncle George, and then I graduated. The reason why I couldn't go to Louisville was I couldn't get a signature unless he told me I couldn't get financial aid or nothing.
Right.
So I said, if you're not going, like, I asked coach, was he going to redshirt me or whatnot? What was he going to do? And he never said anything.
Okay.
So for a whole week, the man don't call me back. The assistant coaches call me telling me, yeah, we're going to talk to you about it. So after a while, I was like, I got to go. I'm going to get taken care of. Like, I got to make sure these people are going to get me a scholarship. So I signed with Ohio State because Kentucky had already gave their last scholarship out to Roger Groves and Tony Delk. So
right.
I was like, well, I ain't going there.
Right.
And so I didn't have – I was basically like – because I told everybody I was going to Louisville. I told all the other coaches. And Ohio State's the only coach that called and said he noticed I didn't sign on that Friday.
Right.
And I was like, man, I had everything set up, but he didn't do it. So it was one of those situations I was forced to do it because I didn't have anyone to sign for. Like, my uncle wasn't my legal guardian, so I had been signing my mother's signature for since seventh grade. Like, I used the same physical forms. You know, you guys bring the physical.
Right.
I've been changing the date on that thing for 7 years.
You're listening to R&R on Sports on the Kudzukian Network. Derek, so may I ask, what happened to your mom, man?
She got caught up in the street life as well. She started drinking, drugging. And we lived in the same city. Louisville's not big, but she lived in the East End. I was in the West End, so it's pretty much far away back in the day. It's the 80s, so wasn't like you could just call somebody. It was still pay phones, no cell phones. So,
right.
And I literally just went to school. I went to school every day. I stayed in the West End, never went anywhere. Then when I was in high school, when I was working, my grandmother told me, my uncle and my grandmother told me, your mother was looking for you. And come later to find out, my uncle didn't want her around because she was so bad off. So I was like, man, that's terrible. So when I didn't see him, but neither one of them signed me for basketball. I won two middle school championships, two high school districts, college championship, NBA. Neither one of them stepped foot in the gym.
Wow.
And I told all these kids, it's like, man, you can't worry about what your parents do. You got to worry about what you're going to do.
Right.
Exactly.
So if you really want to make it, you got to quit making excuses and do something for yourself. Like, and this was in the 80s, so it was real hard. It wasn't no Google, wasn't no job interviews.
Right.
It was nothing. It was like, you go tie your shoes up, you go mow some grass, you go shovel some snow, you go carry people's bags and grocery store.
Yep.
Like, I wouldn't work, and that's how I survived. It wasn't like it was a genius thing. It was the right thing.
Right,
good things
right.
happened to me because I worked hard. I didn't sell drugs, never sold, and I grew up in it. Like, when I tell you I grew up in it, like Daryl Griffin would tell the story, he used to run through our neighborhood because he went to Duval. He used to run through our neighborhood because if you wasn't from there, they didn't trust you. They thought you were infiltrated.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, that's our lifestyle that we grew up. You would get shot, killed, anything could happen. And for me, growing up in it, guys were like, man, stay away from this. You go play ball, young. We'll look out for you. But don't come across the street. So it was like one street to scroll, and you had to literally stay on the other side of the day. But if you came across that street, you was considered one of them. So I knew to keep my face going to that court, that gym, and going to work.
Listen, this is R&R on Sports, and we're speaking with NBA champion Derek Anderson. Derek, riveting story, and one that I can actually corroborate because we kind of grew up in the same neighborhood. So the fact that you were able to lift yourself out of that community, I imagine getting to Ohio State was quite a life-altering experience. So can you describe the process of going to Ohio State? And you've described it as the best time you've ever spent in your life.
Yeah, it was unique because since I was a kid, and we lived here in Flint, Michigan, we struggled a little bit, but I just remember when I first got to Ohio State, my uncle took me up there. And I had never had my own bed. You know, I did, but it's been so long where I had my own bed with lights, with heat, with air, like all those little things that people take for granted, I had them again. And I was like, man, this is good. Like, you know, I got my own. Like, even when I stayed in Uncle George, it was nice, but it wasn't my own. It was like somewhere else. And I just felt like, man, I can breathe a little bit. I ain't got to go to work tomorrow. Like, I can just go play ball. I know my son's mother was back in his life, so we split custody. So it was like, I had my own time. I could be a kid again.
Right.
You know, and I went to funny things. We went to, like, Eddie George is my pod mate, like me, him, Greg Simpson. Like, I had, like, a crazy Terry Glenn. I had, like, all pro players. We didn't know at the time. We were just kids.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember going to the training table and eating, and I was packing food like I was still in the project.
Wow. Wow.
Dudes was like, man, what you doing? I'm like, man, I'll make sure I got something to eat later. I'm going to grab it. They're like, nah, man, we got food later. We got this. And I'm thinking like, ah, man, I'm tripping. Like, you don't pay attention because you've been so used to doing stuff like saving food, doing this. I'm like, okay, I got my own. I ain't got no job.
Right.
I ain't got no money.
Right.
And I still couldn't get financial aid because my mother never wasn't in my life. So I couldn't apply. I had no money. So I'm still literally living day to day. Like, how am I going to make this move? How am I going to get some clothes? I'm still in survival mode. And they were like, nah, we good. And I was like, nah, So I'm still taking bags. I'm still like food, wrapping. I'm taking real plates too now. So they're just like, man, you got to bring that back. my mind was so conditioned on survival mode, man. I just didn't get out of it. And it was funny to them because they didn't know my story.
Right, right. Well, hold on, Derek. Don't tell it all right now. We're gonna take a break real quick. But we're going to come back. We're going to really get into and dig into, number one, more of the story of at Ohio State, but also the transition to UK and to being a national champion under Patino. So listen, stay right there. We're going to be back with R&R on Sports right after this.
This is Dr. J.
This is Shaq Adosha.
Yo, what's up? This is Ice Cube.
And you're listening to a little R&R
on Sports.
Back for more R&R on Sports.
Back
with NBA great Derek Anderson. Derek.
Did your Alzheimer's kick in? Because you like kind of paused right there. Did you forget his name and stuff?
No, I did not.
Oh, okay. I was just checking.
I did not. That's called pacing.
Is that what that was?
That's called, you do that for effect.
Oh, okay. So he was trying to be dramatic. He's trying to be dramatic.
Derek Anderson.
I didn't forget his last name. I was just checking.
Excuse
man.
Him. Listen. No offense meant, but he's straight out of Louisville, man. So. The lower Louisville.
Oh man, watch out now.
So, Derek. Talk about how somebody who came home at a very young age to find an empty house and is suddenly alone in life ends up becoming an NCAA. So we talked about going up through, talked about Ohio State. So how'd you get to Kentucky?
Well, the first part, I think it's like I grew up with I knew my great grandmother who was born in 1901, and she told me she should tell us stories about how she grew
up. Wow. My grandmother was born in the same year. That's beautiful.
That's something else, yeah. So
and you were born like 2 years after that.
Boy, don't make me talk about your people. Yeah. Go ahead, Derek. He's sorry.
You're good. She just explained to us about how she saw her brother get hung for, you know, looking at women and.
Oh wow!
Where'd she grow in Kentucky?
No, she was in Alabama.
Alabama, okay.
We had family in Alabama. Then they killed the rest of the family, but they all ran and went to Tennessee, and then found their way to Casey County in Liberty, Kentucky. So they were kind of just running from those people.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like a story. And she said, look, we ran for our freedom. Don't you ever, you know, face that. Don't ever feel like you're doing the wrong thing. You better survive. You better do this. So she taught us how to, you know, clean up after ourselves. Like mm-hmm. We go to her house. She lives in Beecher Terrace. She said, y'all, when I get done cooking, you do the dishes. You do this. You like learn to take care of yourself. So, you know, even when we did that as a young age, I was remembering like 8 or 9, she started telling us all this stuff. And I was like, man, that was like, that's deep. And those 2 years, I think, prepared me to be on my own. Like she said, no, you got to learn, because I learned how to clean, cook, I learned mm-hmm. how to do all that stuff mm-hmm. when I was like 9, 10 years old. So it almost was like God saying, like, well, this is why I'm bringing you her, because you got to go through something.
Right.
And I felt like that was part of my growth and my manhood, that I had to learn how to take care of myself. So once I learned to do those things, I realized I'm not going to make no excuses, because I know what to do. You know, so I felt like that was something for me. And then going from Ohio State, I was having a great year. It's my second year. I learned how to take care of myself, working jobs, and just doing everything. So I just remember when I tore my left ACL, of having a great season. I won the Junior Olympics, MVP. I was doing really well. Then I tore my left ACL up against Michigan, Fab Five. And I was like, man, not against them. I know I was having a great game. It was crazy. They were showing me respect. I remember getting hurt. Jimmy King and Jalen Rose came and picked me up. And I was like, man, that's crazy.
Wow.
Superstars cared about me. It was more respect. And I was just remembering, like, man, it's crazy. I know these guys on TV. Now people in Louisville saying, man, we see you on TV. And it was just amazing, man. But I knew I had to make a decision because my son was getting older. And
Now how old is he now? Then, I mean, how old was he then?
He was 4 years old at that time.
Wow. So you had a 4-year-old that you took care of.
Yeah. I was 14 when I had him. He was 15 when I turned 15 when he was born. He's born August 1988.
Wow.
And I was born in 73, so.
15 years.
Yeah, no, it's crazy. So, but when people, when I went to see him, I used to catch the Greyhound and go back down to Louisville. And I was like, you know what? I can't keep doing this. I got to be closer to my son. So I said, you know what? And I knew I wasn't going to Louisville because I didn't trust that coach.
Right.
And I was just like, okay, so what do I do? And then once I said I'm going to transfer, my phone, my Uncle George's phone started blowing up. Like Rick Pitino called like 3 times in one day. A bunch of other coaches called, and I was like, I can't go nowhere. I got to be close to my son.
Right.
So I said I would go to Kentucky. And when I transferred to Kentucky, it was like I sat out that year, went and did what I had to do. Sorry, I was going to see my son. I was just in a different place at that time. I knew I had to make sure he was straight. And then we won a national championship, and everything was good. And then my grandmother passed away right after she seen me win a championship in Kentucky. And she grew up knowing about, you know, the hatred, what they told us growing up was, you know, UK was racist.
Right.
To the coach. And that's what my grandmother said. She said, baby, don't worry about them. You make sure you change the narrative now that it's not racist anymore. You got to make sure that people know that it's okay for black people to get their education.
Well, that's what I will say.
Say that. Well, I was like, well, that's powerful. Because most, you know, older black women would just hold a grudge about white people.
Well, hold on, Derek. Let me give a little context, because I think you going to UK really did change the narrative, especially for the athletes coming out of Louisville, because we heard about Adolph Rupp. We heard about what happened with Thomas Paine while he was at University of Kentucky, who was one of the first black basketball players at UK. So when Derek, coming from the hood, so to speak, went to UK, it changed the narrative. It really literally changed the narrative, and then winning under Rick Pitino. So I'm going to ask you, what was it like playing for Rick Pitino?
It was fun, man, because here's the thing. We the first group, first time he's had five, there's five blacks that ever started UK. We were the first team. And he got all kind of like hate messages.
Oh, Lord, yeah, I bet he did.
Yeah, and he's Italian. So it wasn't like they held anything back on him either. Mm-hmm. And I think that was some of the fans who had probably been an older generation had not wanted to see that. But once we won, I think they were like, okay, this is the change of the times, maybe. And I think it happened in an instance, because no one expected that. You know, no one expected all of us to come together. Like, I transferred. I was a great player. I started at my school. We had a freshman that came in. It was All-Americans, Ron Mercer.
Right.
Guys who stayed, didn't go to the NBA with Tony Delco. Was All-American. Yep. Like, we just had a perfect fit.
Brownsville, Tennessee. Like, that's right. Fit.
Mm-hmm. And I think once they saw that, they were like, well, man, you know what? Maybe it is a change. And I think everybody in the West End started saying, you know what? It's all brothers on the team. So they looked at me as like, okay, it's not just a, you know, racist school or just a white school. It's like, okay, this is a basketball school now. And I think it changed, because I know everybody in my hood. I gave everybody Kentucky jerseys. They were like, man, thank you, man, and this, this, and that. And it was like, it was a change of times. I know it was some Kentucky fans that were black, but not like it was when I went there.
Not at all. This is R&R Sports, and we're speaking with one of the early Brand Jordan endorsees, Derek Anderson.
So you go to Kentucky, you guys win the national championship, and I'm sure everybody's all happy and everything. You become
a lottery pick
and go 13th to the Cleveland Cavaliers in 1997. Talk about that. Oh my goodness! You got a nice check too, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
I'm introduce you to my friend Fika.
Yes, indeed. Boy, that was like the craziest thing. You know, I never had a bank account before, so I was so hyped.
You couldn't take that one to the liquor store, could you?
Found those $250,000, and they were like, "Man, look at." I mean, we ain't got the tenth of that. So I was like, yeah. So I put it in a bank account thinking I'm going to get all my money. You know, I was like, shit, this is me. I'm going to get me a house. I'm going to get me a car. I was like, And, man, I went to that bank, and it was 127 in that thing. And I called the attorney dude and said, hey, man, who the hell is FICA? All these people you hiring, man. I said, well,
how he getting my bank account?
Man, I was like, man, who's stealing from me already? I said, y'all ain't gonna steal from me, man. I ain't built like that. I'm gonna come see you. He was like, man. I was like, man, I'm on my way to see you, man. So I hung up the phone. Because dude was like, no, those are taxes. I said, man, I don't care what taxes are. They ain't that much. I hung the phone up and rolled the dude's office. He was like nervous in the morning. He's like, man, you tripping.
You rolled up on the brother, man.
Man, listen, I didn't think he was for real. There's no way you're going to tell me that these people take 40% of your money. I was like, there's no way that's real. That can't be real. They're like, yeah, once you paid me, once you paid Joe, you took that money out, this is all that's left. Because I took out some money to pay him, then I took some money out for myself, and then I looked up. I'm like, hold up, man, this is ridiculous.
Yeah. Right.
This don't make sense. He said, no, I had to make sure I take this out for your taxes. I said, you had to take that much? He said, yeah, if I don't put it up and pay your taxes, you're going to spend it. I said, man, look, you need to tell me before you start taking stuff out of this account.
That's it.
I'm used to cash on hand. I make $50. I get $50 when I leave my job. And I worked at a candy store and a newspaper. I'm like, come on.
Right.
So it was funny, but nobody taught me financial literacy. Nobody, who's in my family going to teach me?
Right,
nobody
right, exactly. Exactly.
And nobody was paying those type of taxes. Here, you pay taxes when you get it, and you can get it back and file and all that. Like, I had never witnessed that.
Right.
So let me ask you a quick question. Are you satisfied or convinced that now these young cats get that kind of education, get that kind of information and exposure and whatnot that you had to get the hard way? I mean, is it better now?
Here's the problem, though. Like, they give you information at the NBA, which is cool, but who's teaching him? Because here's the problem. You still got to pay people that's telling you that. And here's another problem. The kids that are making this type of money are usually first-time generation.
Absolutely, right. Absolutely.
So they're still running into the same problem. Who's going to teach them how to count that much? Like, Steph Curry doesn't have a problem because his dad.
Yeah,
like,
right.
Certain guys whose dads who had it, who has that brothers or family, you don't have that issue. But for the guys who the first generation of this type of money, they don't. So they're going to run into, you see them run into the same situation. They're wearing all this jewelry, buying all this. Like, I had one house my entire life. I had apartments where I only had a bed and a TV. They used to laugh at me. I'm like, look, dude, like, I ain't built like that. I ain't built to spend like that. Like, I had jewelry, but I had cars. That was my thing, cars. But I wasn't buying stuff that was, like, just going to be gone in a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
But mine was out of fear. You know what I mean? Like, I was out of fear. Like, okay, I can spend 100 here and the other 100 I got to put over here. Like, I started learning that. I still learned a lot of bad, like learn how to handle it because there were some bad decisions I made. But for the most part, most of these guys are first-generation family, so they're not getting information. And here's another part. They're scared to come to people who already know.
Mm-hmm,
they'll go to, I tell all of them, I said, why do you need an agent? I go speak to them, they're like, why do you need an agent? He said, well, man, everybody else got one. I said, listen, dude, you pay a dude to get a contract like I did, but I didn't have an agent. I got a contract. I let a guy who read a contract tell me this is the same thing M. Michael Jordan had.
Mm-hmm.
He said, it's the same contract. You don't change that. You're on the rookie scale. This is how much you're going to get no matter what.
Mm-hmm, right.
You don't need to pay someone 2 or 3% for that. They're not doing nothing.
Mm-hmm, right.
You're the number one. I told Ben Simmons, you're the number one pick. Tell them I'm not giving you no agent fee. You can get a marketing fee. Whatever you bring in, you pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm already number one. Why am I going to give you 2% of something that everybody in the world knows?
Right.
They still fall for it. They still hire an agent. They still pay them 2% or whatever it is. And they're just eating out these kids' money. These kids won't listen to someone who's already been there. They'd rather listen to a guy they think his title makes him better.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the issue that we have. They're scared to grow up. And if they do want to grow up, they'll grow up under someone they think who's successful because he's got another guy under his name. They don't realize it doesn't matter that way. It matters on what you learn. Self-education is how you keep your money. These kids are too busy running around spending it instead of learning how to save it.
Are you able to break through to some of them and school them?
Every blue moon, I get one or two, but the rest of them, they're just like, they're caught up in the moment.
Right.
They'll see it, though. They'll be like, man, I don't even need no agent. I did my contract. I average 16 points. Kerry Kiddo's average 15.9. I get paid more than him, period.
Wow. Wow.
It's that simple. You're going with leverage.
This is R&R on Sports, and we're speaking with Derek Anderson, former NBA player Derek Anderson. Derek, you were one of the first players to sign to the Jordan brand. Can you give us a quick synopsis of how that came about?
Yeah, I tore my right ACL, so I had two ACLs in college. I was a fifth-year senior from sitting out.
Right.
So I tore my other ACL. So I go to Nike Town. I'm thinking they just going to ask me, you want to get some shoes? So I walk into a room, and it's Phil Knight and Michael Jordan sitting in there. And it's just him.
Wow.
I'm looking, I know this dude.
That looked like Mike.
Yeah, Michael Jordan said, "What's up, D.A.? How you doing, man? How's it need?" And I'm like, "I'm good." I'm thinking like, "How the hell this dude know me?" And then he told me, he said, "Nah, man, I've been watching you. I love your game, man. I've been peeping you. I see your rehab is going well." So he had somebody watching me rehab. I was on time. I never tripped. I was always had a good attitude. He's like, I want you to be my first member to sign with my Jordan brand. I want you to represent my shoe company." And I'm like, "You do know I tore both knees up." I'm like, "Your company's called Jump, man. I don't even know if I can still jump." But he trusted me. He said my character stood out to him. He said everybody he spoke to, I spoke highly on my character, how hard I worked. And he said that's why he signed me to represent. And I told him I don't want a regular old deal. I want a different deal. And he was like, "Why would you turn down money?" I said, "I want to make sure that I got something later for my life, for my kids, my neighborhood." And he was what's that? I said, "Can I get a lifelong contract with just gear and clothes, just so I know I got that?" And he was like, "All right." So I took that deal. I got a lifelong contract with him. So every year I can get what I need to get to a certain amount, and I get free clothes, free shoes to my foundation and all that. So I thought about the future more than I did money.
Wow. I know your son is a very well-dressed and happy boy.
All of them. Well, they all get excited. But they earn everything. They got to clean. They got to cook. They got to do stuff that I did before you get anything.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
There you go.
I like that.
You might have a house, but you still don't do the stuff you did like you start. Like you're in survival mode. Take care of yourself.
That's beautiful.
Because if daddy ain't here, you still got to take care of
yourself. So talk about him. Tell our listeners about your children.
I got six boys.
Six boys.
Yeah, my wife and I were trying to get a girl, but our first two boys are older, 31 and 25, and our younger kids, 12, 10, we teach them, you're gonna speak to people. That my kids walk up to people now and say, "Yes, sir, my name's Joshua, my name's Garrett," and they look in my eye and they shake their hand. Mm-hmm. People be like, "Well, man, your kids are different." I said, "No, my kids are normal.
Yeah.
Your kids are disrespectful. They're different." I'm talking about my kids, they're different. My kids are supposed to do that. They're young men. They got to be mature. They got to be respectful to adults and everybody.
Right.
So I just teach them the life stuff that I taught me, man, that I learned. It's like the more I treat people with respect, the more I got respect. So my kids are good kids. They work. But here's the thing. If they want phone, they want video games, what have you done for somebody else? That's
okay.
What I ask them.
Okay.
What have you done for somebody? You always got your hand up. What have you done? So they know now they be helping kids out. It's school. They do all kind of stuff. They didn't bring shoes to school to give to other kids. And we don't make a big deal about it, but it's good for them to know it's cool to give that. It's cool to give away, especially when you've been blessed with so much.
Right.
So my kids are very giving. They loving. They always, but they know they get, the only way they're going to get something, they got to do something.
So
they'll come in our room and start making a bed up, but they know they're going to ask for something.
That's outstanding. So here's a question. To be it, you got to see it. So who did you see? Did that come from your grandmother? Who did you see in your life that made the impression on you so that you could train your children in that way?
I think it was a variety of people. Like I said, my great-grandmother taught me that. My Uncle George, who taught me to be a man, he was really instrumental once I got with him, older, later in life.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a lot of people, school teachers told me, don't fall asleep on death. They didn't know my situation. But she said, "Son, you're better than that. If I see you with your head up, I believe that you really care. If it's down, I don't think you care." And that just her having a conversation with me, Miss McGill, having a conversation with me, he said, "You know what, somebody does care outside of my mother and father." And then the high school coach who let me spend the night over his, I stayed with high school coach for a few months because I didn't have nowhere else to go. So just those people opening their doors up, and it was because of their motivation, saying, "Hey, if you stay here, you got to do X, Y, and Z." I was like, okay, I got to be a man. I got to own up to my stuff, and I got to, ain't nobody going to give me nothing. I got to earn it.
Man.
And I think that was the big thing. Everyone around me taught me how to earn everything.
This is riveting.
Once I learned how to own it, once I learned how to earn stuff, that's what I taught my kids. Like, they have the same threshold, same mindset. Different lifestyle, but the same mindset because I taught them. If you're not going to teach our kids this stuff in schools and at home, they're never going to get it. They're going to make excuses, and we're at alarming rate of suicide. Like, we should have been killing ourselves and getting hung.
Yeah.
Brutalized by police and growing up in a project like I did, but that because they've been babied so much, as soon as you tell them no, they think it's the end of the world.
Right.
Well, we've never taught them how to handle themselves and survive. Be happy with what you're doing.
Man, this is riveting. And
we got to come back. We got to bring it back.
We got to bring it back. We got to do that. But in the meantime, right before we go out, what is it that you want to tell everybody? Could be what you're doing, could be something you got coming up or whatever. But as quickly as you can, tell them what you want them, and you need them to know right now about what Derek Anderson's doing.
Well, Martin Luther King and Malcolm X and those guys, they weren't billionaires. So stop trying to chase money and chase a legacy. My thing is to leave more than your name and to give something back that can outlive you. So that's my stamina foundation, man. Do stuff that's going to outlive you and again, to leave more in your name. When you do that, man, you'll become immortal and people will love you even through your life and even after that. So leave more than your name and do something for somebody else and you'll have a better feel. You'll have a better life and a better feeling of yourself.
How can they find Stamina Foundation online?
StaminaFD.com. That's it. Just StaminaFD.com. You'll see everything we're doing. We're making kids go to work, speak to each other, just cordial conversation. We're teaching them how to be human beings again.
Soft skills. You
know, being mankind. So just be nice to each other, man. It doesn't cost a dime to be kind.
There you go.
NCAA champion and NBA champion Derek Anderson, thank you for being on R&R on Sports, man. This is like we say it all the time, like being in the family, like being a made man, but you got to come back.
Yes, sir. Anytime
you need
me, man, I'm back.
Y'all
just let me know.
Fantastic, home. Thank you, man.
We'll be back for more R&R on Sports right after this.
Funking up your airwaves and jamming the good information in your ear. Once again, it's Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Back.
Back. Back.
Keeping on our
your
way
head above water.
Yes, 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 yes. So, no.
Making a way if you can.
Yeah, okay. So here's
temporary
the significant
layoff. Good times. Okay. Easy credit ripoff.
Shush, grasshopper. Okay. So the significance of that horrible rendition. Horrible. Terrible and horrible rendition of Good Times was that. Unfortunately, a few days ago, we lost. If you're a Good Times fan, you will know and remember Wilona.
Absolutely.
Whose name was, given name was Jeanette Dubois. And
Penny's mama.
Penny's mama. Janet Jackson played Penny, and that was her mama on Good Times. And she passed away in her sleep a few days ago, and we're going to miss her. We're going to miss her. I don't know if she wrote it, but she sang and performed the theme to the Jeffersons. And she was a fantastic actress, singer, and entertainer. And
that's your shout out?
That's my shout out to the memory of Jeanette Dubois.
That's cool, right. Man. That's real cool.
That's right. So shout who you got?
Memories. I'm a shout out. Probably one of the smallest brothers on the court. And that was Chris Paul last week. Number one, Chris Paul. From a leadership perspective, he saw that there was a problem with the All-Star game and made it a point to change it. Mm-hmm. Made it a point to let the commissioner know right after the game, look, this can't happen no more. Mm-hmm. This is terrible. So once again, I want to give a shout out for that. But I also want to give him a shout out because he caught an alley-oop at 35 years old. I don't know where he got the spring from. It must be that plant-based diet he's on. He's feeling a little lighter. He's feeling a little lighter. So
didn't they bring an aluminum ladder out there?
No, man.
I saw him taking the ladder off.
No, they pitched it to him. They pitched it, man. Pitched it up, man. Russell Westbrook and Russell Westbrook passing a ball.
Wow,
was just a beautiful thing.
Ain't that something? Ain't that something? Well, listen, we got to get out of here. We got to get out of here. Another great opportunity for us to be with you here, R&R on Sports. We appreciate it.
Rip off.
My name is Howard Robertson.
Stepping and surviving.
Tell the folk your name, crazy.
Larry. My name, Larry.
My name, Larry. That's all he can say. Be back with us next week for more R&R on sports. Take care of yourselves. Take care of each other. And
we love you.
You've been listening to a little R&R on sports, written and produced by Howard Robertson, Larry Robinson, recorded and mixed in Memphis, Tennessee. Don't know all this guy.